be far superior to the American. Alhamdulillah. Wassalatu wassalam. Al Rasulillah wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajmain. Amma ba'd. A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytani rajim. Bismillahi ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Wa man ahsanu qawlan mimman da'a ila Allahi wa amila salihan qala innani minal muslimin. Rabbi shrah li sadri wa yassir li amri wa halul 'uqdatam min lisani yafqahu qawli. I welcome all of you with the Islamic greetings. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May peace, mercy and blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be on all of you. You are most welcome to ask any questions on Islam and compliance religion or the propagation of Islam. So then question, they're most welcome, brothers and sisters. Yes, brother.
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sir, after a person is dead, all his relatives and all, they give money to the poor, they feed the poor, so that sawab goes to that person who is dead. How far Islam says about that?
As far as when a person after his dies, people do many charity, etc., and that sawab goes to the dead, how far is it true? There are two aspects of it. If a person gives charity, if he gives charity, he'll get the sawab. But there are certain things that after a person dies, only few things that really help him after he dies. One thing is the knowledge. Whatever he spread, that's one thing. The good deeds he has done. For example, he has opened a hospital for free treatment. People being treated, so that is Sadqa Jariya. And one of them is the children. The nek amal, the righteous deed done by the children, how he trained them, the good deed they do will add on to his account. Otherwise, the account is closed. Person dies, account is closed. A few things the account runs, the meter it runs. The knowledge that he has spread, the good deeds he has done. There are certain things, for example, your father was sick. He could not go for Hajj. He had the money but didn't have the health. So you go, that's to Hajj-e-Badal. That's followed. So certain things with the amal done by the children, the knowledge given by the parents to the children, that meter keeps on continuing. Sadqa-e-Jariya. And the good deeds he has done. But a person dies, he never knew anything, didn't follow Islam, and now you do something, you do charity and build a hospital for your father who was far away from Islam. Do you think you go to Jannah? That way all the rich people go to Jannah. Correct? Right or wrong? So money cannot get to Jannah. The Prophet said it's more difficult for rich man to go to Jannah. So just by doing charity, fine, it was the wish of your father, and the father said, from my wealth, make a hospital. He made a will, alhamdulillah, then he'll get a sawab. But he dies, he was far away from Islam, never prayed, never did anything, and then you are a good Islamic person and you say, I built a hospital of the father, the name is there, Haji so and so, may not have gone for Hajj, whatever it is. This will not get him any way closer to Jannah. But what did you do? You will go to Jannah, inshallah. Because no bearer of burden can bear the burden of others. That's what the Quran says in several places. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Brother, I have a question about there are rape victims, battered women, abandoned babies and terminally ill children and cancer, AIDS, leprosy patients available around India and in the world. But there is no Islamic NGO right now in Bombay to do dawah on them before they die. For the Akhirah, as spreading a deen or Islam would be the best charity. Now, there are also 20,000 little girls who were kidnapped by rebel soldiers a few years ago in two African countries and are still held in captivity. One would wonder why should we be concerned as we are so far away. Because my dear brothers, sisters, as a human being, our mother, sister, daughter, or if you are a man, then we are connected to one. And pain is the same, even if it is across several seas, several countries. Just imagine, brother, 7-8-year-old girl gets raped over and over again by 15-20 men over weeks continuously, the first night till 6 a.m. and constantly thereafter. This is not one child, but 20,000 girls in Uganda and Sierra Leone in Africa. And it has happened in our country in the Gujarat riots, in Afghanistan, in the Bombay riots, and keeps happening. Some Christian missionaries are taking care of those children who have escaped and are too ashamed to go back home. I ask, how come our Muslims haven't reached there to do our dawah on those needing souls and Christian missionaries have?
Sister, ask you a good question. The terminal patients, some with cancer, some with AIDS, some with diseases. No one is approaching them to dawah in Bombay or in India or throughout the world. And I do agree with her. And she gives the example of rape victims in African countries in Gujarat. Sister, I totally agree with you. But you are talking about this few thousand or maybe 10,000 or maybe a few lakh. What I am talking about, sister, there are billions of people throughout the world who are healthy, who have not received the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what I am talking about is, why aren't the Muslims going to these billion people? The terminal is also equally important. I'm not saying not important. But when we aren't going to these billions of people who are easily accessible, what you're talking is of higher level. First, I'm telling the Muslims that at least pass under 10, then talk about 12th and a degree and a post-graduation. What you're talking is perfectly right. I don't disagree with you. But what you're talking is of a graduation and a post-graduation. I'm telling the Muslims, at least start doing dawah. There are more than 4 billion people in the world who do not practice Islam. What we Muslims are lacking is, we aren't doing dawah ourselves. So what your concern is right, sister. I should first introspect myself. Am I doing my job as a Muslim? See, the point out is very easy. I went to this organization. I am asking you, sister, how many terminally ill people did you visit? You as an individual person, every day can visit 10. Yes or no, sister? Sister, can you visit 10 people or not? Or at least 5? Yes or no? Sister, I am asking a question. Can you visit 5 people a day or not? How many on average do you visit?
Once in a week I visit.
Once in a week. Our beloved Prophet said, "Balighuni walawaya." Propagate even if you know one verse. It's not that you're asking a question, so I'm giving you back. It's not like that. I'm praying to all of you that leave us at terminal, at least talk to the healthy friends that you have got. That's why we give talks on dawah destruction, on concept of God, major religions. What we are telling, that fine, what you are saying is a requirement. But the bigger requirement, what is easier? What is easier, that should be done first. What is difficult, if somebody is doing alhamdulillah, I wouldn't prevent anyone going to these people. But what I am telling, that at least let the person pass standard 2, standard 3, standard 4. And then I will ask him that, why don't you become a graduate or a postgraduate? The problem with the Muslim Ummah is that we aren't reading the Quran and following it. These Christian missionaries, they are more dedicated. Though they have got the falsehood with them, yet they get results. Because Allah is with us, our results are superior. It is not because we are doing the job, it's because Allah is with us and the Haqq is with us. But if we do the work, if we have the dedication what the Christian missionaries have, believe me, wallah, majority of the people in the world would be Muslims. Majority. The problem is that we don't have that much of zeal which the Christian missionaries have. And there are limited Islamic organizations involved in the field of dawah. So what you should do, sister, you should start. Instead of once a week, go daily. You will surely get friends along. How did IRF start? Inspired by Sheikh Dida, we started. And now, mashallah, we have about more than 70 employees in IRF, and we started a school, 70 employees. Now we have a branch in Chennai, another 40 employees for 85 students. So we grow. Muhammad Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was one, then it became 5, then it became 100, then 1,000, then 10,000, now we have billion people. What we say, why aren't you doing? I'm saying, why aren't I doing it? And yet I'm not satisfied with what I'm doing. So sister, you start, and you call people that who's ready to join me. Not why aren't you doing? You should ask your friend who is willing to come with me. And surely you'll have one friend, then 2, then 5, then 10, and you grow. The thing is, what happens if someone does a job? People normally think, okay, he's done this, now you should do that also. Then you should do 3, then you should do 5, then you should do 10, then you should do 20. This is the age of specialization. Sister, we know, I agree with you, that to speak with the terminally ill people is a requirement. But if there are two options, we are taking the thing which is more required. Somebody should take the other. If we had dais, if we had duats, surely we would have even gone to the terminally ill patients, to the hospital, to the organizations. What we feel, that what is easily accessible, we aren't doing that. So what is more difficult, that is there in our mind. We would like to go door to door. These Christian missionaries, they go door to door. They knock at the Muslim houses, day to day. Door to door they go and they give dawah of Christianity. How many Muslims are going door to door? Even in our center, we aren't going door to door because we feel going on the satellite is more important. If we cover that area which is much more easily accessible, then we go door to door. Door to door requires more manpower than to go on the satellite than to give public lectures. We don't have the manpower with us. Even after having 70 people full-time paid employees, we don't have enough speakers. We are getting calls from different parts of the world, from Australia, from USA, from Canada, from Hong Kong. We can't go because of the work we are involved in. So the thing, sister, is that each individual should realize that Allah will ask him what he has done or what she has done. Allah will not ask, why has any organization in Bombay done it? Allah will ask each individual human being, each individual Muslim, what did you do for the Ummah? So this is a nasiha not only to the sister, but to each and every one of us here, including myself, that Allah will ask us, that have we done the capacity Allah has given us. Have we done our duty? And if every individual, even if 5% or 2% of the Muslims realize this, then the world will be a different place altogether, inshallah. As far as the question regarding rape victims, I do agree with you. It's happened in the African countries, in Gujarat. I know of many organizations who have supported these people, not that they haven't. But yet what they have done is very little. I know of organizations that have taken up these children who have become orphans and have given them education. I know. But what we have done is we have scratched the surface. Not the Muslims haven't done. There are many non-Muslims who came, and the Christian mission is their speciality. When any calamity comes, that's the time they give food, they give clothing, and that's the time they win their heart. We people talk about Islam, you should do this, do that, and the stomach is empty. How can the person concentrate? These missionaries, they give them the basic necessity and they win over their hearts. They use deceit. We should not use deceit. We should use the haq to win over people. There should be Muslim organization. We should go to calamity, not only to Muslim calamities. Even a calamity before the non-Muslims, we should be the first to reach them. The problem is that very few people of us are involved in this field of Dawah and the work of Islam. Inshallah, we hope that we have more people and more organizations involved in this field so that we can do a better job as far as enthusiasm is concerned in the Christian missionaries, and may Allah accept our efforts. Hope that answers the question, sister.
A shave our heads while performing Hajj at Mecca, and Hindus, they also shave at Tirupati. Is there any scientific reason other than religion?
That was the question, that Muslim, when we go for Hajj and sometimes Umrah also, we shave our head. The Hindus, when they go to Tirupati and they go for their pilgrimage, they even shave the head. Is there any scientific reason? That the reason we Muslims shave our head is because if we analyze that a look of a person depends a lot on the hair. Therefore, you have hairstylists, you know, different types of hair, and then you have the pung style and this style. And even the ladies, that's the reason that Islam says that a woman should cover her head, because the beauty also lies in the hair, different hairstyles, etc. Now, when we go for Hajj and we shave off our head, it's for humility. That for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's sake, we're humbling ourselves. It is mainly for humility, not that Allah wants our hair. Allah doesn't require even the animal to sacrifice, neither the blood, neither the meat goes to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's our piety. So we're shaving our head to show that we humble ourselves before our Creator. So that's a sign of humility. That for Allah's sake, we're ready to humble ourselves. That is the reason. Maybe that is a similar reason why the Hindus may be doing it. Maybe. But I mainly in my talk, people ask me, that why didn't I use these examples in my talk, similarity to Hinduism and Islam? And I said, I'm talking about those similarities which are not known by the general public. And certain things may be a coincidence or may be a fact. But that doesn't get them closer to Tawheed. For example, we circumambulate around the Kaaba. The Hindus all circumambulate around the statue. The reason we circumambulate is because it's the commandment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and a prophet. The logical reason I can give is because when we circumambulate around the Kaaba, we are testifying there's one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they also have a custom of circumambulating around their idol. So again, in the scripture it is mentioned there's one God only. So I mainly have gone to the scriptures, quoting their scriptures about the authenticity, which is more powerful for me rather than quoting these examples, which they'll be satisfied. Ah, now we are circumambulating, we are doing right. But what they're doing is wrong. They circumambulate around an idol. So I purposely leave out these similarities, which may be very striking in front of a normal human being, but may mislead a person. So I give examples of those things that do not do idol worship, as mentioned in the scriptures. That's much more better to get them closer towards Islam, rather than mentioning these things like circumambulation or shaving the head, etc., which is a fact. So why we do, I'm giving the reason. It may have been the same reason there, but because they manipulated it with an idol, which is not the case in Islam, the moment I give that similarity, it may mislead a person. That is the reason in my talk, which is commonly known by many people, they may not have thought over it, but it's commonly known that when they circumambulate, they're circumambulating around an idol. It should not be same as, you know, that Kaaba is not an idol. And I've given the reply that we don't worship the Kaaba to be an idol, because Kaaba is the Qibla, is the direction. We don't worship the idol. And as I've given my answer, various reasons I've given, including that at the time of the Prophet Muhammad, there were Sahabas who stood on the Kaaba and gave the azan. This indicates that we don't worship the Kaaba. No Hindu will stand on the idol he or she worships. So I bring out the differences also, not trying to mislead a person. That's the reason I didn't include this. But the reason we shave our head is for humility, humbling ourselves in front of the Creator. Hope that answers the question. Any sisters have any questions?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum assalam wa barakatuh.
We actually don't know what is the purpose of the various groups like LET or Al-Qaeda. Is it for the cause of Allah or something else? So can we pray for them or the one who joins them? What should we as a common Muslim should be the attitude with?
This is asked a very common question in this scenario, that the various groups like Al-Qaeda, etc. So can we pray for them? We don't know the purpose, and can a person join? Sister, even I don't know the purpose. If I've been expert in doing research of Al-Qaeda, I could have told whether they're right or whether they're wrong. I don't know. If you lay your impression based on CNN, BBC, you'll have to call them as terrorists. So when people ask me, is Bin Laden a terrorist? I said, Allah Alam, I don't know. If you want to pray, what you can pray? That if Al-Qaeda is on the haq, may Allah be with them. If they're not on the haq, may Allah not be with them. Simple dua. No problem. Correct. If they're on the right path, may Allah support them. Neither the government can catch you. Neither a Muslim person can tell you what you're doing is wrong. You pray that if they're on the haq, if they're on Quran and Sunnah, may Allah support them and my du'as are with them. If they're not, then may Allah not support them. Matter is over. Regarding can you join Al-Qaeda? I don't know Al-Qaeda, so I cannot tell you if they can join or not. Before they have to do a research. If someone tells me, can I join IRF? I can do, okay, IRF is following Quran, Sunnah, X, Y, Z, so you can't join. So those organizations who I'm aware of, I can give you guidance. I have not met any people of Al-Qaeda. I don't know them also. I read in the newspaper. But don't go on the newspaper. Newspaper may be right, may be wrong. Like the person who was caught in the pota. Afroz. If you ask me what my logic says, I haven't done a research, I can't say 100%, whatever limited knowledge I have. And when I spoke with the lawyer, he told me it's just a gimmick, just to come in the media, the police wanted to come. What research I did, because I spoke to the lawyer, and this I can say, that is most probably 99.9%, it is more of a media hype. They wanted to say, okay, they caught someone, so they want to be in the good books of America, that I've caught someone, you know, all nonsense. Even this sounds like a gimmick, I cannot say for 100%, I haven't done a research on it. So sister, if you ask him about Al-Qaeda, I haven't met any people on Al-Qaeda. I don't tell you to join, don't not to join, I don't know. You have to do a research. You have to do a research whether they're good or bad. If they're good, join. If they're bad, then don't join them. And the best prayer is that you can pray that all those people who are in the way of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, throughout the world, whether they've been Palestine, whether they've been Kashmir, if they're on the haq, we pray for them. And may Allah guide these people who are on the wrong. And if they're on the wrong, may Allah guide them. That's also good dua. If Al-Qaeda is on the wrong, may Allah guide them to the haq. Similarly, people say George Bush. George Bush should be killed. May Allah's wrath come on him. When I had gone to UK, all these people, there's a group. The group is very militant. And after I gave a talk on jihad and terrorism, I said, you got up after the talk. I told all the people out here, we curse George Bush. May America be destroyed. So I told him that the better dua, that Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he had hard times, he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. There were two Umars who were very staunch enemies of Islam. He prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at least give one Umar hidayah, come on my side. And Hazrat Umar, may Allah be pleased with him, who was one of the staunchest enemies of Islam, became the staunchest supporters of Islam. Khalid bin Walid, you have the example. He was a sword, called Sword of Allah. He never lost any battle, even when he fought against the Prophet. He won. Then he became a sword of Allah. So I told the people that if you pray that, Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, give George Bush hidayah. Give the Americans hidayah. That's a better dua. So therefore we have to pray to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that all those on the wrong track, may Allah give them hidayah. So these people who have got power, if Allah gives them hidayah, they will come on the true side. And we'll find that Islam, the true religion, the religion of peace will spread. That's my style of doing dawah. And I pray for that. That's a better thing. And I feel that's more effective, and that's the style of the Prophet. At times, Prophet did curse, etc. But on a whole, if you analyze his lifestyle, it was more of, you know, praying for them coming to haq, so that Islam flourishes. Hope that answers the question, sister.
Brother, I have a medical shop, and I want to ask about certain things, whether I can sell it or not, like certain cough syrups which have alcohol, and then we sell some contraceptives also. So which one is allowed and which one is not? Can you give me the answer?
I was asked a question that he has a medical shop. Can he sell cough syrups containing alcohol, contraceptives? Brother, as far as the Quran mentioned, no less than four different places. In Surah Baqarah, chapter number 2, verse number 173. In Surah Maidah, chapter number 5, verse number 3. In Surah An'am, chapter number 6, verse number 145. And Surah Nahl, chapter number 16, verse number 115. After mentioning the prohibited foods, It says that if under compulsion you have these prohibited fruits, then Allah is Rahman or Rahim. Means if your life is in danger and the only thing that can save you is a particular food, for example, if you are in the sea and you are in a boat where storm has come and you have no contact on land, and pork is the only thing available on that boat, on that ship. So for that time, though pork is prohibited, it becomes permitted for you, but the moment you come on the shore, it becomes prohibited. Similarly, if alcohol is the only drug that can save your life, then it becomes permitted. But I am aware, being a medical doctor, that many of the drugs and the syrups, they do contain alcohol where it's not a necessity. Sometimes it's a necessity, sometimes there can be substitutes. So what I would suggest, that since it's a medication, the onus lies on the person purchasing it. For example, you sell a knife, and you may be selling knife to cut vegetables, but if he uses for murder, so he's to blame, not you. What I can suggest, that you can give other alternatives of cough syrup which do not contain alcohol. And now research tells us that alcohol is not the best solvent. They use this as a media. So there can be other substitutes. So you as a Muslim, you can sell substitutes which do not contain alcohol. At the same time, I wouldn't say it is haram to sell, but if you promote the other drugs, it's preferable. As far as the contraception is concerned, again, if you hear my answer on family planning, I've given the reasons where in normal circumstances it should not be done, unless it's advised by a medical doctor that if the life is in danger, that if she undergoes, if she has one more pregnancy, if she has several cesarean sections, she has had multiple cesarean sections, 4, 5, 6, and if the gynecologist say that one more pregnancy is detrimental to her health and she can die, under these circumstances, as a last resort, family planning and contraception can be done. So if you are selling certain products, and if you know that the majority of the people purchasing are indulging in wrong things, I personally would prefer that if you don't indulge in these things. For example, it'd be copper tea or the other things. So these are mainly used for wrong activities. It again depends upon a taqwa. But if you know if someone uses it, this contraception, for a reason which is jais in Islam, which is permitted in Islam, then it's fine. But if you know that most of your customers are not using for this purpose, so as far as the temporary method is concerned, the difference of opinion among the scholars, whether it's allowed or not allowed. As far as the permanent method, OC pills, all the scholars unanimously agree it is haram unless it is used for medical reasons. So that depends upon each individual, where does he fall in. But if you feel it falls in the grey area, I in your position wouldn't have sold it. I being an individual person, I wouldn't have sold it. But I'm not giving a fatwa that it's haram to sell, that I have to ask a faqih. But as an individual person, if I was running a medical store, I would not have sold these things. Because I know that most of these are used by people for reasons which are not jais in Islam. So I as a person individually would not have sold. There's a difference in fatwa and a taqwa. The fatwa you can take from a faqih, it depends on individual taqwa. So I and your position wouldn't have sold these things. But that depends, I'm not giving a fatwa as haram to sell. Because I'm sure that in various reasons, Islam does give permission if it's detrimental to the health. But since most of the customers that buy from you, they may not be falling in this category, I personally would avoid it if I was in your position. You can take your own decision. Hope that answers the question. Wa akhir da'wana alhamdulillah rabbil alamin.